my channel. I hope that everyone has been enjoying these reviews. Welcome to part 3, where we will be covering Love is Blind season 3, episodes 8 through 10. Now, if you guys haven't noticed, just to give you guys a quick little preface, we do not cover these episode by episode because I just feel like that's a little boring. And by now, a lot of y'all have essentially watched all the shit and you're just here to hear my opinion and my review. Also, if you're new here, you don't know that I'm a very judgmental, pretentious piece of shit. Even though a lot of you guys probably are like, no, Ivana, you're so nice. I've been watching you for years. Don't say that about yourself. Listen, I'm a Capricorn. You see the necklace? So I'm gonna take all the criticism that comes with this, okay? Because if you want to put your life out there on the internet and on television, we're all going to judge you. Okay, listen, y'all know I really don't think all of that about myself, but you know, this is what the people be saying in the comments or whatever. I know that I'm a perfect little angel. Understand, we're all judgmental, especially when we're watching these damn TV shows. So comment down below, what do you guys think about the season so far? Do you love it? Do you hate it? Honestly, I'm eating it all up. And let me just say, we're gonna give some spoilers right off the bat because I was stupid enough to go on Twitter because I was trying to find out some information on a cast member and I spoiled episode 10 for me, okay? I spoiled episode 10 for me. I was very late to the party. And I see that SK left Raven at the altar. First of all, I still don't really like Raven like that, but did I not say that SK cannot be twisted? Did I not say that shit? Can we just call me Cleo Mademoiselle? Can we give Mademoiselle the Mademoiselle like a fucking psychic show? I'm gonna get Momo, everybody that was talking about stuff. SK's so nice, he's so perfect. There's nothing wrong with him. Why is he single? I told y'all something was wrong with that man. All of the men on this show is loyal basura. Except for Brennan. But I think there's something that may be wrong with him too. I don't know. But we shall see. All right. So let's get started now, shall we? We have the notes. God damn it. We have the drinks. Now, I am a new dance teacher and I have to teach in a few hours, so we are very, very sober today. This is actually passion fruit juice, and I also have some water with some Mio on the side just in case this finishes before my time, okay? Because I got a lot to say about these episodes, all right? So, of course, we are starting with episode 8, and I'm gonna go through this mainly by talking about couples, you know, case by case, and then, you know, going about what happened in each episode, if we shall, right? But you are free to grab your liquor, roll up your weed, or whatever the case may be, and enjoy the rest of this video. And I'm ready to drag. We're gonna give the read of the century. During episode 9, it wasn't giving, and then the weddings started happening already. I don't know, I feel like this season went a little fast. I don't know, is it just me? I don't know, comment down below. You agree? I don't know. But let us just start with episode 8 now, shall we? Now, of course, watch my videos on part 1 and 2 to get updated on everything that I already said about these cast members. But starting off with episode 8, we see a very sad, stressed, and frazzled Colleen who probably got cursed out by her husband-to-be because she went out to the club, okay? Now, let me just say, I like Matt. I do, but I think Matt has some serious psychological issues, okay? Now, Colleen is doing ballet. We finally get to see this ballet that she's been talking about. And if you guys also do not know, I'm a dancer. Well, clearly I'm a dance teacher, so I had to have danced a couple times in my life, right? But ballet is not my forte. I don't really like it. I think it's boring as hell. But ballet is the foundation of most dance genres, and you have to really know ballet in order to, I don't want to say teach dance, but if you know your ballet, you know your turns and all of that, more than likely you're going to be very good at other things in dance, right? It's like the building foundations of dance. So I was very eager to finally see her dance, but like, damn, y'all saved that shit for episode a million? Like, let's be real. That's how Colleen got her man. I'm a ballet dancer. I do ballet. I love ballet. Ballet. And we finally see she doing ballet, and she's really good. I was like, oh shit. Like, I was shocked to find out that she was actually like a PR strategist, or did she's something else. I was like, but y'all made it seem like all she does is ballet. So it was interesting to see like she was, you know, doing ballet or whatever. And I'm like, oh, okay, bitch. All right. no Abby Lee. So I ain't about to be judging her dancing, but like, you know, she was, you know, doing a really good job. And she was talking about how she was stressed and how dancing really brings her into her element, and how, you know, Matt has really been kind of stressing her out. And at this point, she's starting to have second thoughts about her and Matt, because like at this point, he just be going off the rails. And I think we could all agree that he just be going off the rails. Like, let's be real. But we also have to think about the fact that we all just seen these people essentially fall in love. And I have to say fall in love, because I don't think it's humanly possible to fall in love that quickly. Like, it's very, very rare. And the fact that all of these people are just using the "I fell in love with you, I love you" literally within a week of knowing each other, and then they're getting married that quickly is just insane. Like, married at first sight is one thing. Like, you don't know them, you're just being married to them, and then they slowly fall in love over time. That's a little bit different. But like, these people, like, y'all met each other through a wall and you're like, "I love you, I want to be with you forever." Like, I'm in jungle. No, you don't. It's just ridiculous, you know? But it makes it worse when you're in a house with someone after you fell in love with them and you made this emotional connection with them. And then you start seeing that anytime something that you do bothers them, they go off the deep end. You know, so I can't necessarily blame her, because you saw that she genuinely fucked with old boy, bro. Like, she was in love with Matt, you know, even though, let's be real, in the pause, that was her last choice. She got dumped twice, even though she was a ballerina, and all the men thought she was hot because she was a ballerina. And then all the men saw her from the pause and they thought that she was hot. And even though after the pause situation and everybody met each other in person and they saw that the ballerina actually was hot, which, to be honest, that's their opinion. I mean, I think she's average at best. Kevin Samuels' voice. But like, it's just like, I don't understand it. Like, I was like, okay, like, you know, I'm not gonna lie, I feel her. And it's sad to see, because I really think she really did like the man. She really did, but now it's like, ooh, you're doing it a little too much, eh? Ooh, como se fait tout pour moi. You're doing a lot, my friend, you know? It's like, when things get rough, are you always going to just run away? And now we see Colleen is meeting Matt's friends, and now we start to see a little bit more of who Matt is. Apparently, Matt is all bark and no bite. And I'm like, oh, this is probably why I like Matt. Matt reminds me of a lot of the men that I used to fuck with, and a lot of the men in my family, okay? Y'all all bitches, okay? And I could comfortably say this behind my screen, because y'all ain't about to do shit about it, because y'all all barking no bite, all right? Like, okay, it's something I'm comfortable with. A lot of bitch ass niggas, they ain't about to do nothing. I ain't talking about my man though. He ain't all barking no bite, trust me. That nigga bite, like, he don't hit me, but I'm saying, like, he say something, he do that shit. But like, not even my father's not like that, my man's not like that. But like, a lot of the men that I grew up with and a lot of the men that I've dated, like, I'm not even gonna lie, like, they let me do whatever the fuck I wanted, and that's why I didn't respect a lot of men. I'm not even gonna stunt. Like, that sounds crazy, but hey, at least I'm honest. So that's probably why I love my man so much and I actually respect him, because he does not let me do whatever it is that I want. He holds me accountable, and I actually care about what he has to say, and I actually care about what he thinks. You know how they say, when someone actually puts you in your place, or like with kids, when you actually hold them accountable for their actions and you discipline them, they actually listen to you? I think it's like that with human nature across the board, whether you're a child, man, woman, whatever. Like, if someone lets you walk all over them, you just gonna keep doing that shit. And sadly, I had a lot of adults that just was like, let me do whatever the fuck. So when I come across people that I actually care about, actually care to listen to, I love that and I respect that. So it was very interesting when his friends was like, oh, you know, like, you know, Matt is all talk and, you know, he not really gonna do nothing, because for whatever stupid reason, and this is another issue that I have with everybody on these fucking shows, they divulged their information to the friends. You know, basically they were like, oh, how's everything going, da da da, and basically they started talking about their two blowouts, right? Basically when Matt was ready to basically leave for her for day, okay? Okay, let me not say that, but basically where Matt was like mad as hell and was gonna leave her the first time as well as this recent time, and it was like, oh, well, you know, don't mind it, you know, Matt is a little, you know, he just like that, he all barking no bite. To be honest, the way Matt has displayed himself on television, just disregard the fact that clearly there's a lot of editing involved, and of course a lot of things are missing, and there's a lot of good moments we clearly don't see, it is a little bit concerning. But I do know a lot of people that do act like Matt. I had to think about it. I was like, yeah, I know a lot of people that act like Matt, all bark no bite, especially my mom is one of those. Like, the way my mom be screaming, yelling, hooping, hollering, you would think that she probably committed a murder before and she probably got a hidden body under the mattress. Like, I kid you not. But like, my mother has never laid a hand on a goddamn soul. I don't think my mother's even gotten in a fight before. Like, when I started telling my mother I got into a fight, she was like, you fuck. Like, she was about to cry. And I'm like, bitch, like, sit down. Like, ma'am. It was just so funny. So it's just like, some people really are all talk. Like, you know, they get into these intense modes where you really, really think, like, yo, you about to do something. Oh my God, they're so violent. Oh my God, I would hate to be with them. And it was like, you ain't gonna do nothing. You know, so that was, I guess, reassuring for her. And I guess it kind of put her in a better place, which is very interesting to see exactly what his friends had to say about it. And then we find out that Matt is also known to not really be in serious relationships like that. As a matter of fact, Colleen is his first serious relationship since his ex, who was a high school sweetheart who he was married to, that had left him, that we found out about in the pods or whatever. And ever since, he has earned the nickname to date Matt or whatever the case may be. Like, literally, he runs away from any type of commitment. He doesn't seem to be able to trust anymore ever since that situation. And Colleen is his first serious relationship after that. All I gotta say is, Colleen, you better run. First of all, I don't think Colleen is mature enough to handle this type of trauma. I don't think Matt is mature enough to handle this type of trauma. I don't think any of us are mature enough to handle this type of trauma that we're seeing. Let's be real though. A lot of us have been through some type of traumatic heartbreak, right? So I feel like a lot of us have to put ourselves in Matt's shoes, right? And think of our worst situation that's ever happened to us and be like, all right, how did I feel? How did I treat other people when I was in relationships after? Because I see a lot of myself in Matt. That's probably why I like him. I see a lot of my friends in Matt. I see a lot of people that I know in Matt, in terms of the self-sabotaging, the latching out, the trust issues, the just being ready to pick up and leave at any given moment when something seems to be going wrong, not wanting to be played. Like, it's crazy. Because I'm like, damn, after my ex played me, literally like left me for his best friend's ex and got married on her, and I had to drag him on Snapchat. Listen, I don't have a Snapchat to this day because I'm so embarrassed for how I had to drag that man on Snapchat, okay? And I'm in a whole nother relationship now. That shit happened like, what, 6-7 years ago? But I'm still like, damn, that was so bad, you know? A lot of us have had really, really horrible moments. Like, when we really think about it, a lot of us have had really bad moments. And a lot of those bad moments have been brought out of us because of these relationships that we've been put through. And it's like, he should have went to therapy. He should have did the inner work before he went on this show trying to find a wife. Like, you haven't even had a serious relationship after the fact. Like, nigga, what? Like, I was like, wait, now, okay, the Lacheys, who are the producers of this fucking shit, y'all are fucking assholes. Do y'all vet these fucking people before they get on the show? Like, you guys should be asking these types of questions. What was your longest relationship? What was your worst heartbreak? Did you recover from this? Did you go to therapy? Like, because you guys are fucking with people's lives right here. There's no way he should have made it on the show. I'm sorry about it. Like, what have you been doing to cope with this? Because it's going to blow back on Colleen. It's already blowing back on Colleen, and it's only been like 2 days. Let me stop, like, what, 2 weeks? Whatever it can be. Damn, it really has been like 2 weeks. But it's just, it's horrible. So, of course, we're moving on to Bartice and Nancy. I'm very annoyed with Bartice and Nancy, okay? Because, of course, episode 8 opens up with Bartice just complaining about how he has no attraction to Nancy, and basically everything's been plaguing him. The fact that her ex is so involved in her properties, the fact that she has such different views on abortion and him, the physical attraction just isn't there. ABC, XYZ, onomatopoeia, I don't give a fuck. A whole bunch of shit that doesn't even matter. Like, a lot of the things that Bartice is talking about is not even next. Serious. Like, you could be dealing with so many more serious things. Nancy is gorgeous. She's a wonderful catch. She has net worth. She is literally financially literate. She owns property. She has an amazing job. She has a career. She can build with you. She'd be an amazing mother. Like, I don't understand. Like, all of this shit that you talk about, it just sounds like you trying to find a way out, okay? So that's basically what we're getting at this point. You know, the scene opens up with him bitching, crying, complaining, and saying that since he has to deal with all of this shit and all of this shit is weighing on him, you know, maybe that's why he doesn't want to have sex with her, basically. You know, all of these things, you know, that's why he don't want to jump her bones. Yes, he used those words. I don't even smoke, but nigga, go fucking hit a blunt, my guy. Like, chill. Like, I don't know what's up with him. And maybe he has, like, legit
anxiety or something. It's just, I've never seen anybody like this. I feel like he's just trying to find a way out though. I don't know if he wants Raven. Raven's not even thinking about him. I don't know. I don't know if he got some girl back home. Possibilities. All right, I just thought about it. Here's my theory. I think he has another bitch somewhere on his line. Somewhere back home, somewhere doing something. Because the way he's acting don't make no fucking sense. It just, it don't. And there's one thing I know about men, because I've had a lot of men tell me this directly. Anytime a man wants to literally find his way out of a relationship and he doesn't want to hurt you, he's going to try to self-sabotage the relationship by telling you he's a bad person, he's going to lose interest in you, he doesn't like you, he's going to try to destroy your confidence, he's going to try to do all of this extra shit, and this is exactly what Bartice is doing. So I'm just sitting here like, I've seen this before because it's happened to me. So I'm just like, okay, he either has another girl or he has another girl, or he genuinely just doesn't want to be with her. So I'm like, okay, either he's banking on Raven or there's another girl somewhere doing something. Like maybe he has like the one that got away type shit. I don't fucking know, but something's not right there. And what really breaks my heart is this is really destroying Nancy's self-confidence. Nancy is like really, really hurt by the fact that clearly he's not physically attracted to her, and whatever else is plaguing him is starting to seep into their relationship. They're barely intimate anymore. He barely talks to her. He just really don't give a fuck. She talks about how she vomit cried. Okay, that's what she said. You know, she's telling him this, right? She's like, yeah, you know, I vomit cried. And he, I swear to God, looked like this. While she was saying this, I swear to God, I want to reach through the television and just give that nigga a pata swell, okay? A pata swell is basically a slap, a really big fucking slap. I wanted to slap the shit out of this man. Because how the hell is your girl telling you that she was crying and you just sitting there with a straight face? If I tell my man I'm crying, he crying with me, point blank period. Because my man does not ever want to hurt me. If you claim you love that bitch so fucking much, why the fuck you let your bitch cry? Sorry, y'all, I'm from the hood. That's why I had to call her a bitch like that. But I know she's not a bitch and I don't think she's a bitch. But you guys understand. Do a little caveat here. I know there's a lot of people that really don't like Bartice right now. And they're like, oh, you know what? I don't give a fuck that Raven was doing jumping jacks while Bartice was pouring his heart out. You know, he's not shit. I don't give a fuck. What Raven did was fucked up. It doesn't matter who the fuck it was. You don't do shit like that. And it just shows that you have no emotional maturity. Point blank period. I still don't like Bartice. I still don't like Raven. Let's move on. To be honest, I think Nancy should run. Even though he did apologize by the end of this conversation. And you know, he's like, you know, I am sorry I hurt you. I don't believe it. Believe it, you know, but I will say that it does seem that their relationship does get better from this point on. Of course, let's move on to bae that will probably never be, Raven and SK. Okay, now this right here, this conversation right here in episode 8 had me crying. Okay, SK and Raven were having a conversation about how everyone is so dramatic, right? Everyone has so much going on, and yeah, they're not perfect, but everyone is so full of trauma. Sweet. Hot, bust it down, Do y'all not know y'all on a reality TV show? Do you think we just watch this show to watch y'all fucking sweep your goddamn kitchen and put on your fucking wig and drink coffee and wash your ass and go to the park and do Pilates? What do you think people watch reality TV shows for? The drama, the tea, the entertainment, lights, camera, action, fuck is you talking about? And then she's like, I mean obviously, like, we're boring. Yeah, well, until the end. Thank God you guys finally kicked it the fuck up, because at this point I understand why you were here. But like, it was just like, nigga, this Netflix at that, the messiest of all fucking like networks in terms of dating shows. Did you not see The Ultimatum? I wanted to fucking throw something at her dumb ass. And you know, you got SK sitting here co-signing. Yeah, you know, our relationship is different. You know, we on a different path. Basically, they was giving very, we're not like other couples. And she was giving, I'm not like other girls vibes. Because then we start talking about how apparently Alexa was asked, I think in the confessional, who would make the worst wife or something along those lines. And she said Raven. I think that's really fucked up. I wouldn't say something like that about somebody. I would just be like, I don't know, maybe me, if anything. But I would never say something like that about another cast member, especially not someone now that I consider a friend, or someone that now I'm going through a similar experience with, especially such a unique experience with. But apparently that's what Alexa said. But you know, she kind of saved her ass barely by saying like, oh, you know, it's because you're so independent and you know, you don't really rely on anyone, blah blah blah. And I'm just like, Alexa got some nerve, gall, and audacity to be sitting here saying that. Because Alexa, babe, you you come from a privileged family. Your dad's house alone is worth over $2 million. Brennan, I'm very sure, does not make nowhere near as much as you or anyone in your family makes. And more than likely, he will be at a great disadvantage if this relationship doesn't work out. Like, in short, you're more independent than he is in terms of if we're talking just financials. Like, I feel like you're very independent as well in different ways. So I'm trying to understand, like, what Alexa was trying to say, you know, like, about Raven. Like, I didn't really like that. And mind you, I don't even like Raven. So see, this shows that I'm independent my damn self, and I'm capable of giving unbiased commentary even when I don't fuck with somebody, all right? I don't like that. That was fucked up. And Raven also said that that genuinely made her feel bad, because she's like, you know, I'm not like other women, you know? I know that. Like, all these women, you know, on the cast, like, they have that I want to go to Disneyland vibe. I want to stay at home and have my husband come to me type of shit. And I'm just not for that. That's not what I want to do. That's not what I'm here for. You know, that's what they want to do, and that's fine, but that's not what I want to do. And basically, she's like, if I was like that, you know, you wouldn't have picked me. To be honest, though, the way she said that whole spew didn't sit right with me, because that was giving me I'm not like other girls, okay? We all know the I'm not like other girls types of girls. And we don't like that I'm not like other girl type of girl girls. It's like, girl, shut the fuck up. We all got pussies. We all bleed from those pussies. And at the end of the day, this pussy gonna get played just like every other pussy, all right? That was kind of annoying, but like, I don't like that Alexa said that. I don't like that she was hurt by that comment, because that could really destroy your self-esteem, especially when all of y'all are like late 20-something, early 30-something, and feel like you're literally beating against a clock that really doesn't exist and is ridiculous as fuck. And like, you feel like something's already wrong with you because you haven't found the one conventionally, and like, someone's telling you that you would be a bad wife. That's not okay. Alexa, you fucked up for that. And you my girl. You my favorite. Like, literally one of my favorites, but that was fucked up. I did not like that. I was like, oh no. I was like, yeah, that yikes. She would have had to catch these hands for that. Of course, we have Zaynab and Cole, right? Now, Zaynab and Cole are a roller coaster. They actually give me a legit headache. I want them to work so desperately bad, because when they're good, they're good. I think they're a very amazing example of opposites attract, and they're a very good example of me and my man in terms of like opposites attracting, but at the same time having so much in common. Like, me and my man have very different personalities on the outside, but we're extremely similar. And it's so interesting, because when they're actually having fun together, it's so beautiful. And I'm just like, oh, I ship it. Like, I love it. But then Cole is just so immature and problematic and disrespectful that I'm just like, run, Z, run. Like, Zaynab does not deserve this. Zaynab has been through a lot. Okay, we found out that she lost both her parents at a pivotal age. Okay, she was a teenager grieving for all of her teenage years because she lost both her parents. And from episode 8 through 10, we just see her grieving a lot, you know, because being married is a very, very huge milestone, you know? You want your parents to be there. You want your friends to be there. All your loved ones, you know, you want them to be there, and she doesn't have the most important ones there. I believe certain people aren't going to be able to fly out. Like, I think it's her sister and aunt, don't quote me on it. They're not gonna be able to fly out due to flight issues. So she's practically gonna be alone. And to add insult to injury, as we found out in previous episodes, Cole's family wants absolutely nothing to do with this wedding, and they do not want to meet Z. But spoiler alert, they have no problem following her on Instagram. Make it make sense. Insanely disrespectful and disgusting. That's a very bad sign, you know? And they also made a comment about how she looks, or, you know, talking to Cole about like how they didn't expect her to look like that, or they didn't expect him to pick a girl like her. And we already know that Z is a little insecure about herself. She doesn't feel like she's beautiful. And I don't care what nobody says, Z is probably like one of the most beautiful, if not the most beautiful girl on that cast. But it's just like, girl, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, it makes me sad, because she does not deserve to feel like that. No girl deserves to feel like that. Like, you should feel like you're the most beautiful girl on this planet. And for you to feel that bad about yourself, and then you have this partner that constantly invalidates you, ugh, I would hope that if they stay together, Cole improves. But at the same time, I just feel like she could do 10 times better than Cole. Okay, I really do. So, of course, we have Cole apologizing for that whole fiasco with Colleen. And the reason we're revisiting that from, like, what, episode -8 is because, as we know from episode, I believe it was 7, there was a whole get-together with everyone in the cast that was even in the houses, not even just that, like, kind of made it to the final round pair or whatever. And basically, there was a whole situation where Matt basically told Z what Cole really said to Colleen, and everything got blown way out of proportion because Colleen didn't know the extent Cole went with Colleen in terms of how he was flirting with her at the first initial pool party. Was it the second? Whatever gathering it was. So she got really, really mad. She was like, maybe we should switch partners. I'm team Matt. Blah, 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 blah. You're completely out of hand. It was a really bad argument. He gets her flowers, he apologizes, and love seems to be in the air for these two. Yay, so cute. And then we see how impulsive Cole can get. Talk about some, I'm so happy, blah, 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 you know, let's get married now. And I'm just like, do you not know that you have an ex-wife for the same reason? Because you like to just do shit? You think this is some YOLO shit? No, no, let's not get married now, Cole. Let's sit the fuck down. Like, I was just like, yeah, see, it is weird because Z was into it. Z was all, hi, hi, hi. And I'm just like, let's not forget. Never forget. Never forget, bitch. Like, you know, I'm so worried for Z. Yo, I swear to God, I really sleep at night, like, worried for Z. Like, I swear to God. Am I the only one? Comment down below. Like, do you really sleep at night worrying about these people? Because I do. Because I'm concerned. I'm thoroughly concerned for Z. Again, like I said, love seems to be in the air. You know, they even do a lock activity. Now, if you guys are not aware of, like, these lock activities, there's certain places around the world. I don't believe Texas is the only one with the lock bridge. Maybe it is. I don't know. Correct me if I'm wrong. But they do this lock activity where basically they place their initials on the lock. And, you know, this is basically supposed to signify your love and lock your love in forever. Again, insane. Y'all just met each other, like, yesterday. It's giving, I'm desperate. I hope none of my friends ever go on this fucking show because I'm not. Anyways, so they do the lock activity. And, you know, of course, you have Mr. Jokester over here talking about some, oh, my God. God, I dropped the lock. But this is the right lock. Trying to be all romantic. Y'all, it was just ridiculous. So, you know, the thing is, I want them to work. Because I actually do like Cole, even though I feel like he's immature and shouldn't be in a relationship. But I don't like what he's doing to Z. So I'm going to have to be team Z on this, you know? Moving on. Of course, we have our boring couple, Alexa and Brennan. Yeah, they're boring as shit. But I love them, okay? Problem that I see happening with Alexa and Brennan is that Alexa is more than likely going to keep trying to change Brennan. I already see it happening. And I think Brennan's gonna have absolutely no problem with changing to an extent until it becomes too fucking much. One thing I've learned in a lot of my relationships, literally from the first one to now, men don't like being changed. Men don't like feeling like there's something wrong with them. And if they want to change something, they're gonna do it on their own fruition. Whether we're talking about something as little as their clothes to something as big as their religion. So of course we did find out that Brennan wanted to convert, okay? He wanted to become Jewish. A lifestyle change, that's a religious change, like that is a big ass change. And there's a lot that goes into that. Like, I believe you can't just do that, but I also believe that since she's Jewish, any kid that they have is automatically gonna be Jewish. So it's like, it's a lot of logistics. And also there's like this thing in their religion that's kind of like a prenup that he has to sign. The thing is, the way I'm looking at this, it seems like he has a lot more risks than she does. And I don't like it. I don't like it. I don't like it because everything that she wants and everything that she basically requests, he does. And it's like, how much are you going to do that? So in episode 8, basically it opens up with Brennan meeting her friends. And first of all, let's talk about the friends. I don't like the friends. I don't like the slick little comments they made. First of all, they looking like the plastics meet 90210 rejects. Said what I said, lots of plastic surgery, lots of fake designer going on. Maybe it's real, I don't fucking know. It's just, it wasn't giving for me. Their attitudes wasn't really giving. Of course they were interrogating him or whatever. Per usual, it was a regular meeting, but they made a comment like, oh, well, we saw him. We didn't know if he was the cameraman or not.
he doesn't look like her type.
In what world do you think that that comment is appropriate? I would love to know. That was a pretentious comment, it was an ignorant comment, and it was a disrespectful comment. Because one, you're trying to make it seem like, oh, the cameraman doesn't necessarily have any value or is less in value than someone that would be marrying Alexa. You're also trying to make it seem like he's not good enough for Alexa in his current state. And you're basically trying to basically say in general, like, oh, like, ooh, I know that's what she was gonna pick. Basically saying she ain't got good taste. Like, the fuck? Like, you had Alexa, you know? I don't know if he walked in or she brought him to the table. It was one or the other. And she goes, yeah, doesn't he look so much better when I dress him? At this point, I started realizing all the people that I liked for real, I see their toxic traits. I'm seeing their toxic traits and I'm seeing their problems and I'm starting to see why they've been single forever and why they can't find someone to marry. Which, to be honest, all these people are young enough not to fucking be married this early. Okay, live your fucking life. Don't be in a rush to be married, y'all. But anyways, let that man have his own life. Let that man have his own individual style and let that man have a choice. Okay, if he wants to wear lumberjack jeans and a t-shirt, let him wear that. Like, why you gotta dress him? What the fuck is he, your kid, your child? I did not like that. Like, I was like, yup, this is gonna be one of those things where eventually he gonna pop on her ass. Because why is it that you have to dress him? Why is it that he has to conform to everything in your lifestyle? Because then the friends started saying, like, oh, are you ready for this lifestyle? Are you ready for this? Are you ready for that? Are you gonna accept her dad? Are you gonna, like, bro, tranquilo, tranquilo. Like, relax, bro. Like, it was just too much. And of course, Brennan sat there, chill as ever, with a smile on his face. But, like, he's done that throughout the whole season. And that's actually pretty scary to me, because we all know that calm people or people that just, like, keep a smile on their face like that, it's no bueno. Those people, they pop. Okay, they pop. Eventually, they have enough and they start going berserk. They start going wild, okay? And I don't believe that something about this is not bothering him eventually, okay? The whole converting to being a Jewish person, I believe that was his idea, from what I understand. But like, now you want to change his clothes, and it's just been other things here and there that I noticed. It's like, okay, she's not conforming to anything that he wants to do or anything in his lifestyle. It's literally her bringing him into her world, and it's like, yup, this is gonna be an issue one way or another eventually. I hope it isn't. I still love him, and I clearly think they're end game. There's no way they're not gonna be. Who knows? This show surprises me every fucking day. But definitely something to note. Now we have episode, like, 9, which was kind of boring. I literally fell asleep. I was like, yo, this is really fucking boring. Like, I was like, yo, can I, like, take a walk and come back? Like, I was like, yo, if I fast forward this, like, am I gonna miss anything? Like, that episode was so boring, y'all. Like, nothing really happened. It was a whole bunch of fluff. Like, there was no point in that episode. Like, none. They could have just skipped to the weddings. they really could have. But I mean, I guess it was kind of important because this is when we started wedding shopping. The episode didn't really get interesting until, like, the middle, right? So we are gonna start with Raven, okay, going gilet shopping with SK's mother. Now, a gilet is a Nigerian headpiece that is usually worn for special occasions. It's usually that round, rather large headpiece that you see women wearing. It's gorgeous. I love it. I think I want to wear one for my wedding, but I'm not quite sure. Probably for the reception. I always wanted to have a traditional type of African aspect to my wedding because I am Haitian. So, you know, Haitians, we come from Africa. We come from the motherland at the end of the day. So I do want to have Haitian, African, as well as American aspects to my wedding. So a gilet might be part of mine. But what's interesting with Raven is she does not plan on wearing anything African to her wedding in terms of a wedding dress, but she is there to try on a gilet, right? And I think she looks gorgeous in the gilet, you know? She thinks she looks gorgeous in the gilet, but she starts to show her whitewashness, okay? Now, this is not me calling her whitewashed. She admitted herself she was whitewashed, okay? Go watch the goddamn show, all right? This is our mixed queen, by the way. She's black and white, and she has mentioned that her family is very Southern. Those of us in the U.S., we know what that is. I don't know. She said this. This is coming from her, so we can only make assumptions. Don't put words in my mouth. I'm just saying what she said. All right, so basically, she tried on a gilet. She thinks she looked beautiful, but then she gonna say, she should, listen, I gotta say, I'm gonna start saying this. She's showing her American. And guys, I'm not even saying Black American. Just her American. Just no culture whatsoever to say this. She gonna say, I look like Cardi B. In what way do you think that's appropriate? Or like, I just wanted to die inside. Like, as a Haitian woman, as someone that's very in touch with their culture, I'll be damned if I put someone in traditional Haitian clothing, like a carabella, and then they're like, oh my God, yes, I look like Meg Thee Stallion. I'd be like, bitch, no, just take it off. Like, bitch, don't you dare. Like, why would you reference Cardi B in traditional African clothing? Now, I understand she has worn something like that before, but it's just like, no. And then I forgot who else she was with, to be honest. I wasn't really paying attention to that. But she had other people with her, I guess, from SK side. And basically, they were like, oh, do you plan on wearing a traditional African dress or a traditional African gown or whatever? And she said no. And I guess they kind of were taken back from that. And she was like, you know, the only reason I don't want to is because I feel like it wouldn't represent me. And to be honest, I think that's really, really fair. The only thing is, you got to be very, very careful with those type of things, because although Nigerian people especially be sitting there talking, oh, we're so welcoming, we're so accommodating. Yeah, but this is a Black and white woman, literally a mixed woman coming into the family, and she's talking about some, she don't want to wear a traditional African dress to her wedding where everybody in the family is going to be there. And this is like literally her second son to be married. No, you have to do something, because no, bitch, like, you're a dog. Did she not do her research? Clearly, Raven doesn't know what she got herself into. She didn't do her research. She does not understand this culture. She doesn't understand what she's getting herself into. And she doesn't understand the gravity of what she is or is not doing. For anybody that is in a relationship with anyone in any type of like ethnic type of culture, you need to do your research. There's a lot of things you should or should not do. There's a lot of things that are involved that I don't know how to explain it, but like, you want to do the most that you can to make them comfortable. And it's like, I don't want to say do things to the point that you're very uncomfortable, but like, you don't want to cause problems where they don't need to be a fucking problem. That's the best way to explain it. However, what's really nice is they do want to merge the American and Nigerian culture. So they are going to have certain elements in the wedding. So from what I understand, she's going to have a head wrap, which is a gele, with a American wedding dress. Now, when they're done trying on the geles or whatever, what's very off-putting, to say the least, because all of us, I know, at home, we're like, what the fuck? I mean, I'm Haitian, so I already knew these things. But if you're not Haitian, or if you're not like, you know, Hispanic, Indian, Asian, like, and you're not, you probably like, nigga, what the fuck? Fuck all that. Basically, they start telling her about Yoruba traditions, and what you should do as a Yoruba wife now. Basically, make sure there's always food in the home. Make sure you're carrying yourself very well in the streets so nothing gets back to him. Especially now that he's going back to school and you guys are gonna be very far apart. You don't wanna stress him out. Make sure you're carrying the family name well, especially now that you're his wife. Make sure, like, literally, they're telling her all the types of food that she need to be cooking, all the easy things to cook, all the hard things to cook. Raven is just like, sis was sitting there looking like Donkey from Shrek. Donkey from Shrek, y'all. Look at this picture right here. This is what the fuck Raven was looking like. Donkey from Shrek. She was just shook. She was shook, confused, like, nigga, what? I gotta what? I gotta do what? Where? How? What? As we already established, you know, Raven's very goal-oriented, very career-driven, and very, you're probably just gonna have to eat a fucking sandwich that you make yourself, more than likely. She's not about to learn no damn African dishes to have it ready for him by the time he comes home from school, or whatever the case may be. Like, I don't see it. I don't see it. All right, you know, so it was like, you know, I think she was very, very taken aback. I don't think she expected to be told that or expected to have that expected of her, but they were just like, yeah, you know, just make sure there's always food in the house. Make sure just how you're carrying yourself. Make sure you always respect him. Make sure if you make more money than him, you're humble about it. Y'all, it was crazy. But when you really think about it, is that only African men though? If you don't know those basic things about like a man, or like how to keep a man, so to speak, then that's definitely why you're single. I'm just saying, like, I'm not saying you have to do all those things, but that's just common knowledge. But again, I am Haitian, and at the same time, I'm very aware of how like a lot of foreigners understand things and how the world works and how foreign men think as well. They expect food on the table, they expect this, that, and the third, whatever. Funny enough, my man hates that shit. He hates the idea of like me doing anything for him, so like he does everything for me. It's very strange, because it's like, I'm just a very nice and giving person, so I do everything for everyone. But it's like weird. weird because like with him, he's like, no, don't do that. No, you're not my maid. No, you're not my. And I'm like, could you just let me get the food for you? Like he does. It's very weird. See, for him, it's more of a like, I don't like that dynamic. But like for a lot of Haitian men, that's just how they are. They expect food on the table when I get home. Food on the table when I wake up. This, that, and the third. Like, and I mean, a lot of them, that's what their mothers did. Some men grow up to resent it. Some men grow up to respect it and expect it. You know, so I feel like I grew up kind of like, well, yeah, I think that's what happens. I'm not gonna sit here and do that shit necessarily. It just depends on who I'm with and how they want that to be done. I'm probably not ever, I don't think I've ever done it though. I don't think I've ever done it. But it really depends. It's all on compromise too. I feel like that's a conversation that they need to be having together. But I feel like as a sisterly bond type of thing and to get her acclimated with African culture, that's why they had that conversation with her. SK, on the other hand, is wearing a Nigerian agbada, which is a traditional Nigerian outfit that men wear for special occasions, mainly weddings. I ain't gonna stunt, that shit was gorgeous. I was like, yo. SK looking rather handsome, okay? He was looking real nice in his little agbada, all right? To be honest with you, I was very confused as to what color scheme they were going for because, like, I don't know, but usually when it comes together, it usually looks nice. But something that really stood out to me is SK was like, yeah, you know, even if we don't do things, you know, the 100% traditional way, African people are usually very, very graceful in how they accept things being done, especially at special occasions and weddings, especially when one person is not 100% Nigerian. I have a lot of Nigerian, Ghana, Sierra Leonean. I have a lot of friends from a lot of different countries in Africa, right? Know if I would say they're generous. That's why I'm trying to be like, I don't know what type of African. Clearly, I do know what kind of African SK is because he's talking about some. He Nigerian. He's from Yoruba. And I'm like, he's the most relaxed and chill African man that I've ever met. They're usually very brutal, very blunt, very great and nice people. But like, in terms of tradition and culture, I don't know. Every wedding that I've happened to see has been done the traditional way. Even if there's an American aspect, it'll be two different weddings or two different sections where one part is this way, another part is that way, or one part is done one day. That's why I'm like, I don't know what the fuck SK's talking. I don't know. But I'm not Nigerian. Well, I am according to Ancestry, but like, that's not the culture that I've celebrated my whole life. So if someone can please chime in down below, because when I don't know what SK is talking about. So of course we move on to Raven's wedding dress shopping experience. And honestly, she picked a dress and it was spaghetti strap, very, very low V cut. And it looked stunning on her. It looked like a really beautiful nightgown. Yeah, I call those nightgown dresses. Listen, I'm not just saying this because I'm not really fond of her. I hate those fucking types of dresses, even though they look really, really good on certain people. I just feel like if you're gonna wear a dress that simple, why get married in a dress like that? It's not a wedding dress in my opinion. It's just like, it looks like a really nice curtain. Or just a nightgown. Like, what? I hate those types of dresses because it's like, it's not bridal for me. It's too simple for me. I don't know. But it was really nice on her. Like, it looked really, really great on her. You know, one of her friends was there. You know, one of the ones that was being very rude to SK. And, you know, they were like, you know, since your hair is going to be wrapped up, it's perfect. But what was very interesting is they were making comments talk about some, yeah, you know, I know it's an African wedding, baby, but we need to have something showing. And, you know, basically talk about some, yeah, she needs to have more boob out, blah, blah, blah. They were making comments like, yeah, maybe a deeper V and da, da da da. And it's like, as you guys can see from this picture right here, right, this V is enough. Okay, they were talking about cutting the mesh out, making the V cut deeper. Maybe they were just joking, but even the jokes are distasteful for me. Like, this is a Nigerian wedding with lots of elders that are probably going to be showing up, and on top of that, you're already not even adhering to the traditional Nigerian culture, and if you're talking about literally popping up in a nightgown looking ass dress and making it really thottish for the what the fuck is wrong with you people? Like, I was very turned off by those comments. Like, extremely turned off. Like, I was like, nigga, like, no. Now let's go back to Bartice and Nancy. Now, like I said, episode 9 was pretty fucking boring to me, with the exception of the wedding dress shopping situation. Bartice and Nancy do go for a dance class. Everything's all cute or whatever. But yeah, we don't really care to talk about that because Yeah, wedding dress shopping, right? Of course, Bartice goes tux shopping and wham, bitch, I'm a baby. He's sitting here complaining yet again about Nancy, but this time to his sister, the same sister that was crying about the differences between Nancy and Bartice's abortion issues. And it's very interesting because we find out that apparently Bartice doesn't necessarily seem to have a pretentious bone in his body. Okay, he doesn't care about looks. And you know, he shouldn't be so hung up on the outside world. That's basically the counsel that his sister gives him. Everything that we've been hearing for the past 25,000 episodes is the same thing he says to his sister, how he can't get past it. And she's like, yo, if you love her, marry her, you know, even though, and it's crazy because we all know that sister done cried, started bawling at the table due to her differences on abortion, right? But she's like, yo, like, don't let the outside world, you know, cloud what you have. If you want to be with her. If you love her, you know, love her. You know, you've never been one to care for looks. That's never been something that's ever, you know, really, really plagued you in a way. You know, you've never been one to really care that much. Don't let things like that, you know, cloud your judgment. And I was like, either Bartice is putting on for the camera, they're cutting things up to make him seem a specific type of way, or the sister don't know her fucking brother. I don't know what the fuck is going on. But I'm like, he seems to be very hung up on looks. First thing that hurt Nancy, because I mean, I can't call it disrespectful because at the end of the day, that's his personal opinion, even though it hurts, was that he is not physically attracted to Nancy. So it's like, what are you talking about? He's never been one to be hung up on looks. The man's been talking about her looks the entire time. The nigga's giving shake syndrome. Okay, he's giving shake-alicious syndrome right now. So I'm so confused. You must not know Bartice. You must not know Bartice. I'm very happy the sister did talk some sense into him though. So now we have Cole and Zeynep, right? And let me just point out right here, because I forgot to point it out before I started the whole wedding dress thing. This episode, like I said, is very, very boring. All we see is dance classes and wedding dress shopping. And not all the wedding dress shopping or wedding suit tux type of shopping things were interesting, so I'm not probably gonna touch on everyone's. This experience for Zeynep was extremely depressing because she really, really was grieving for this episode. Like I said, a lot of her family cannot make it to the wedding, therefore they cannot make it to the experience of shopping for the wedding either. So she had someone, she had her sister on FaceTime, you know, she was searching for a dress or whatever, and honestly, I just couldn't. Like, her just crying and breaking down because her parents couldn't be there, and she would sit there and be like, you know, do you think my mom would like this? Do you think my dad would like this? It was just so heartbreaking. I teared with the girl. Like, it was very, very sad. Of course, they take a dance class. Like I said, I don't know why everybody was just taking dance classes. I guess nobody can dance on a goddamn show. Cole also does take a Z on a date, which does seem to go pretty well. But what's very interesting is we start to see how moody Z could be. We start seeing that Z is very up and down. Like, she's all over the place. One minute she's happy, next minute she's sad. And this episode, she just seems to be very, very annoyed. But we also have to take into consideration that she is grieving, and this is probably one of the worst times for her because her parents are not going to be there in one of the biggest moments of her life. She's getting married and her parents are not going to be there. It's extremely depressing, and I can imagine probably one of the most heartbreaking situations to be going through. I will say that, you know, Cole has seemed very, very supportive throughout this, but he is being very selfish about the situation because he's like, oh, you're so moody, you're so this. And of course they get into an argument over this because she's so moody. That is annoying to deal with somebody that's so fucking moody, okay? I'm dating a Gemini, so I know. Dating a fucking person that's so moody all the time, like one minute you're happy, one minute you're sad, and I don't know what the fuck is wrong with you. That's annoying. But we know what the fuck is wrong with Z. Not only is she grieving, but you're a man child. You're annoying as hell. You play all day. La saisonne est joué wap joué. Nobody has time for somebody that likes to play. Doing a joke. You're doing nonsense. I feel like eventually you get tired of that. So apparently Cole takes it upon himself to confront her about her behavior and how she's so moody, and it does not go well. Basically, she's like, I'm not being moody, I don't see what you're talking about. And he's like, there's a time to be goofy and there's a time to be serious and there's a time to just be regular, okay? And you know, obviously that annoys Z, and you know, he starts like getting annoyed too because he's like, oh, why aren't you happy right now? Then he's like, oh, well, do you really want to marry me because you don't like me right now? And basically starts to antagonize her and gaslight her and basically starts to tell her that she's not fun Z. He wants the fun Z, he wants the sweet Z. She's not a sweet person. And I don't know, I have not gotten not sweet from her. Yeah, she could be a little closed off and she could be a little passive aggressive, but I think she's pretty sweet. I don't know. Like, I was just so confused. I'm like, nigga, if you don't shut the fuck up, like, you need to grow up. I was so confused. So now we get into a massive argument, and eventually he calls her bipolar. Yes, he's like, are you bipolar? And as somebody that's bipolar, at this given moment, I stopped liking Cole. He's on my shit list. Excuse me. To use bipolar as an insult just irritates the fuck out of me. It's one thing to be like, oh my god, this weather's so fucking bipolar. Whatever. To sit there and be like, are you bipolar? Basically, she was like, all right, don't fucking talk to me anymore. Like, literally, like, do what you want, don't fucking talk to me anymore. My jaw dropped. Like, who? Are you talking, like, what? Like, nigga. There's just certain things you don't do and there's certain things you don't say, and clearly that is one of them. And Cole has absolutely no discretion. He just says what the fuck he wants and he has no regard for other people. And I'm like, okay, so this is the type of person you are. You're not all silly and goofy all the time. You're a bitch. Okay, he's giving, I just say whatever it is that comes to mind without thinking or understanding that there's consequences for my actions. So I was like, yeah, on my shit list, done with you forever. So Z walks out, Cole goes after her, the episode ends there. So episode 10 it is, now shall we? But before we get into that, we have to go back to Matt and Colleen because I completely forgot. So Matt meets Colleen's parents, right? And they seem to be very, very sweet people. I was like very confused because they seem to be completely different than Colleen. Colleen's very, very sweet too, but like they seem to be a lot calmer than Colleen. Like Colleen seems to be like a firecracker bouncing off the walls and her parents seem to be very, very relaxed. They seemed a little apprehensive about meeting Matt and just about the whole process in general. They seem to be very, very cool about everything overall. They start saying that basically Colleen has never brought anyone home. So that was very interesting because I'm like, you never brought anyone home. Like you're mad young. You come off as very immature. You got the pick me vibes going and you're trying to get married this young. Like it's just, girl, just relax. Go chill somewhere. Go to the bar. Go suck some dick. And of course, Colleen is basically expressing everything that's happened with Matt to her parents. Her parents do not look happy, but it was crazy because they seem to be enjoying Matt and enjoying the meeting until Colleen went and ran her mouth talking about all their fucking problems. Why does everybody on this show like to just tell everyone about their problems? I do understand that no one can really relate to their issues. So it's like when they have the opportunity to talk to anyone that will listen about their issues, it's like, oh my god, yo, you won't believe what fucking happened. They're like, okay. This is what's happening. Okay, well, here's my insight. So I guess when they have someone to actually give them some sort of advice that actually knows them or knows about the process, that's when, you know, the floodgates open and they just start running him out. But it's like, y'all need to understand. To other people, like to us normal folk, y'all look a little nuts already. Regardless of if we understand or not, like a lot of y'all look a little nuts. And if you're trying to get us to like your significant other, you're trying to get someone else to like your significant other and you met them like less than 2 months ago, what the fuck do you want them to say to you? You know, not everybody's gonna be on board with that. So of course her parents look a little worried, but I mean, at this point, it's a little too late to be worried, right? So not all the couples are gonna be mentioned for this one, because again, this episode kind of got a little bit boring until the weddings came. Not all the weddings are gonna be mentioned. I'm gonna be doing a separate episode on the weddings as a whole. So let's start with Nancy and Vartese. So Nancy and Vartese get a welded class bracelet, okay? So a welded class bracelet is basically a bracelet that you get put on that can't be taken off. Like there's no clasps, no nothing. It's just welded on your hand to signify the love that they have for each other. To be honest with you, I was just like, this is so fucking pathetic and so ridiculous. Nancy needs to run.
I like Nancy, but she needs to run. Like, the signs are all there, and it's just like, oh, man. Girl, bye. I mean, it was cute or whatever. I'm probably gonna take the idea from me and my nigga, but, well, no, we already have bangles. But, like, it was just like, oh, my God. For what? Of course, he does take her on a date. There was a lot of dates in this episode. Like, lots of, like, iconic, epic type of dates. They were really cute. I was like, okay, shit. I'm taking these ideas for date night shit. You know, Bartista's sitting there apologizing without apologizing, basically just explaining all the shit that he's done and why it's not great. Anyways, and Nancy's just sitting there in la la land. I don't know why she's so mesmerized by Bartista like this. Like, I think Bartista's handsome, but like not this fucking handsome. She's just like, yeah, everything's so perfect and da 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 da, and it's like, are we watching the same show? She literally is sitting there like, every day you show me that you're the perfect guy, and I'm like, where? Like, you were feeling like crap up until like yesterday, bitch. Like, you just stopped vomit crying. Like, you know what? Don't save them. They don't wanna be saved. Like, what did you do? Now you have the iconic conversation that I feel like ended SK and Raven's relationship. So as we all already know at this point, SK has left Raven at the altar. He said no to her. And it's funny because in episode 9 in particular, even though I said we're supposed to be talking about episode 10, in episode 9, what's very, very interesting is they had this conversation right after Raven came back, from Gile shopping with his mother. They had this conversation about how Raven's family is not going to be attending the wedding. I don't know about y'all, but that's suspicious. And she's like, well, you know, I don't have any family. What do you want me to do? What does your mother want me to do? Not have the wedding? She clearly didn't do her research about African families, Nigerian men, or anything, because you never ever want to regard any African man's family like that, especially the mother. Talk about something, what does she want me to do? Like, that's disrespectful. Like, you do not do that shit. As soon as she did that with that attitude and then rolled her neck like that, I was like, yeah, you don't disrespect any black man's mother. You don't disrespect any African man's mother. You don't disrespect any Nigerian man's mother, especially when that's Yoruba. Hey, I said, is she fucking dumb? As soon as she did that, I said, it's a wrap. And then the whole conversation just went doo, 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 doo. She was talking about how basically she don't got no family, the little bit of family she has left. I think her mother didn't want to participate, but he did talk to her mom, so she knows the wedding's going on. Her grandmother's sick. Uncle can't come. Like, it was like literally a handful of family members, but they just can't participate or do not wish to participate, or, you know, whatever the case may be. And it was just weird to me. The whole thing didn't sound right to me, and I don't believe it. I'm just saying, with the exception of the mother, who clearly doesn't want to participate and clearly did speak to SK, right? She probably just doesn't want to be on TV. But something doesn't sound right about it. That's the reason I went on Twitter and my dumbass ended up spoiling the ending for myself, because I tried to see, like, okay, what's up with Raven's family? What's her family? Like, I'd love to know, because what the fuck is going on? Did y'all dig shit up? Because I want to know. But essentially, I was like, yeah, something don't sound right about that. But what's very interesting is basically she was also talking about how, you know, he was talking about how his family is him and his name is him and her name isn't her, and she's gonna make decisions regardless of what her name is or what her family thinks. Or another red flag. Like, are you dumb? Like, yeah, I was just like, yo, she didn't do any research. And for anybody that doesn't understand what I'm saying, it's also because, like, y'all just don't know anything about, like, foreign ties and foreign families, especially when it comes to, like, African culture. Like, it's very, very serious. Names are serious. Last names are serious. Family, extremely serious. Like, these people don't even date without telling their families, for real. Like, so it's like, you sitting there talking about, oh, my name not that serious, I don't gotta do nothing without my family knowing. Girl, and then you talk about something, oh, what does your mom want me to do? Not have the wedding? I said, hey, you disrespecting my day. Consider yourself gone. I knew he was saying no at the altar as soon as that conversation happened.
And you're an American girl, not a Yoruba girl. Things would have been done different.
I feel like y'all are picking at me, and I'm like, what more do you want me to give? I'm giving y'all exactly what y'all want. Everything you want for the wedding, I'm doing. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of stuff that I wouldn't have this way, but I want your mom to be comfortable. I want your brothers to enjoy themselves. I want your family to like it. And y'all still want to, like, find a problem with what I'm doing. Like, back me up. We're just having fundamental differences on family. Because to me, I'm like, I'm marrying you. I'm not marrying your mom or your brother or XYZ. They are so a part of your identity that, like, I'm me regardless of who my family is.
I can, you know, make my own decisions, but we do have fundamental differences when it comes to the role that family plays in a marriage. For me, it is very important for me to have my family on board. It is very crucial for me to have their backing in this. Finding someone and settling down.
Like, that conversation, y'all, if you guys understand anything about relationships and communication, read his body language, read his face, and read her attitude, and you will know that relationship was over before, like, it was done right then and there. And a lot of people will probably be like, okay, but why did he keep pursuing her? And after that, he did take her out on a date. Why did he take her out on dates? Why was he saying all of those good things on her? But this is the thing, I feel like he still was trying after that. He was trying to see, okay, well, what could we be, you know? But the whole thing is, when it comes to Nigerian men, African men, just foreign men, bro, like, they're very heavy on family. And the fact that they don't have the same
same thoughts and values on family is important. The fact that the family was gonna be there, that's a big one. And the fact that she's just like, oh, I don't really care what your mama want me to do, and I'ma do what I do regardless. Nigga, cut the tape. Cause you know what that signifies to a man? That means our kids are gonna be raised the same way. That means that our kids are gonna have those same values. I don't want my kids to not care about family. Family's a lot to me. That's exactly what that signifies to a man. You guys may not think so, but a man, that's what they're thinking about. A lot of us think that men are stupid, but men are not as stupid as they think. When a man hears you talking about family, when a man hears you talking about values, and you're literally throwing basically your family in basura, and it's like they didn't really do anything to you from what he knows, because who knows? The family could have freaking essayed her, and we don't know, but I'm saying, like, from his viewpoint, from ours, it's just like, nigga, like, they just not involved. I don't really want to be involved. I don't know, right? There's probably more to the story, but it's like, for him, he's just like, yeah, like, this is gonna be my family, and your family doesn't care, and then you're just like, I'm gonna do what I do regardless. Like, yeah, what kind of kids are we gonna have? And what's gonna be their viewpoint on family? What are you gonna instill in them? Because the whole dynamic of, like, foreign culture is the woman is what instills the values of family within the children, while the man is away doing man shit, you know? So it's like, yeah. No, that was the beginning of the end. That's when I went on Twitter and I was like, oh shit, he really said no at the fucking altar. And I said, didn't I tell y'all motherfuckers SK wasn't shit? I told y'all motherfuckers SK wasn't shit. I don't think he's a horrible man. I just feel like at this point, that just wasn't what he needed. He shouldn't have been on the show anyway, because the fuck, you're going to school. Why are you wasting people's time? Anyways, SK does take her on a romantic boat ride. Everything seemed fine after that. Raven seemed to be opening up. They're talking about having kids in the future. But that's the thing I don't understand, because I was like... That conversation was pretty intense to me, but I still feel like he was trying. So of course, episode 9 ended with Cole basically pissing Z off, and Z basically just went to go sit outside. Bitch, you should have drove to Canada. But anyways, Cole tries to go convince her to come back inside, and she comes back inside, which really annoys the fuck out of me. Put your foot down, Z. Put your goddamn foot down. Fuck that man. Whatever. They end up resolving their issues. She's basically saying that she's not going to convince him to marry her, which you should not. Like, you sitting here doing a sales pitch as to why you're the great catch, and I didn't like that. I was just like, oh god, like, I mean, I was sitting there like, yes, that's right, but then I was like, oh, that's cringe, shouldn't have to do that. But it was just sad. That argument was resolved in literally 2.5 seconds, and me being bipolar, I cannot forgive Cole for that. That was disgusting. Brennan does take Alexa on a date, and I love their date night situation. It was so beautiful. Literally he had like their best moments playing on the big screen, like a movie size screen. It was so cute, and you could kind of see Brennan's insecurities popping out, you know, thinking that, you know, maybe Alexa would say no on the last day, or like at the altar on a, you know, scale. Like, she's like, you know, I'm like 65%, and I was like, is she joking? Maybe she was joking. But like 65%, I was endgame at this point. I was like, am I not watching the same show as everybody? I don't know what the fuck. At this point, I started to get a headache. Like, I swear to God, like, my head started getting hot. Cause I'm like, wait, why would she say 65? Like, at least I would have gave it 80. But like, you could tell, like, Brendan's like uneasy. Like, throughout this whole thing, he starts to get uneasy. Everybody starts kind of getting uneasy. Like, everybody's a little nervous, which is kind of normal. Cause like, you know, you're either gonna commit yourself to the love of your life, or you're not, or you're gonna want to spend the rest of your life with your loved one, or they're not. So it's like, ooh. So, going on. Of course, we have Matt and Colleen's aquarium date. Iconic. I loved it. It was beautiful. Ah, oh. My man has to do this for me at least one day. Oh my god, it was gorgeous. Like, I just love animals, and he loves fish, so I really think this can be doable. But it was so gorgeous, and everything was going so well. Got our flowers and everything, and then he talks about how he's had problems basically opening up to her, probably because of what's happened to him in the past, and he basically feels bad about it, but you know, he's happy to be with her, etc. And it's interesting because when it comes time for Colleen to basically speak about how she feels, oh lord, it does not go well. It does not go well, ladies and gentlemen. It does not go well. Because she's basically tiptoeing about what she really wants to say. She's basically saying, you know, I don't know if you'll be there when shit hits the fan. You know, I don't know if you'll continuously be here for me when things get hard. Because so far, every time things get rough or get hard or we have an argument, you just leave. But then, like, she's kind of still, like, dancing around whatever she wants to say. He's like, well, say it. Just say it. Say how you feel. Say it. Say it. And it's like, damn, nigga. Or what? You gonna slap a fish in her face? Like, it was like, relax, you know? Oh my my God, it was just so crazy. You know, Matt is practically antagonizing the girl. Then it gets to the point where he's like, well, I mean, if you had the choice today, like, would you marry me? And she's basically like, no. Y'all, I didn't expect that. That kind of shook me because I was like, damn, like, I knew she was feeling a little indifferent. But for her to say no, hot damn, oh, there we go again. Hot damn, oh, there we go again. Hey, hot damn, again. Let me stop. No, but serious, like, what? I was like, oh, shit. Like, whoa, where do we go from here? Matt's hurt. I thought he was about to kill her. I swear to God, he was giving me, I'm gonna strangle you in your sleep box. It's not funny. Not funny. But I don't know, bro. It was sad. Now, since this video took an entirely long time, way longer than expected, we're gonna do the bachelor, the bachelorette party, as well as the weddings in part 4. So make sure you stay tuned. Smash that like, smash that subscribe button, and turn on that notification bell to be notified whenever I post. Make sure you guys subscribe to my other two channels. I have a Haitian channel where I talk about Haitian history, voodoo, and folklore. And I have a personal / vlog channel where I give advice, do live streams, and other things like that. Make sure you guys join my Patreon. The cheapest tier is about $3 just to support. And with that being said, make sure you guys like, share, subscribe, do all that. Get your merchandise. Join the free Discord because we always looking for new people to come chat or whatever. And I must see y'all next time. Bye!